my thumb. This time I'm going to open all the way down to the wheel head because this is what I'm going to use to attach my bat. Ideally, you watch some potters and they slobber water on a gallon at a time. Ideally, you want to use as little water as necessary. The drier you keep your clay, the easier it will be to get height out of it, and the easier it will be to make thin walls. I don't believe I put my bat on this porcelain. Porcelain's a really spiffy clay body. It's a high-fire clay body which will actually go translucent on camera, which means light will pass through. But you need gas come up and running for that. What I've done here in essence is make a plate. This is the same way you would start a plate. Except you wouldn't put a hole in the middle. And I'm just going to put a series of grooves in it. Choice of bats. I like plywood bats. I like the laminated 3/4 inch plywood bats. I also like plaster bats. If you use a plaster bat, try not to get plaster shavings with trim tools in your clay. Depending on who you read, right? If you get plaster in your clay, it will cause your pots to blow up. Maybe not today. Now we'll say blow up. Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow. It may be 6 or 7 years from now. The plaster embedded in your fired clay will absorb moisture, it will swell and cause your pot to break. That's what people will tell you. Other people will say, that's nonsense. Once you have high-fired porcelain or high-fired stoneware, it ain't going anywhere unless you drop it. Alright, I'm going to slap this down. It might be a little splatter goes out sideways. What I'm going to do is push air out of the grooves I made. It'll create a vacuum which will hold this down. Theoretically, last time I did this, it slid on me. Dr. Czacki laughed at me.
I did. I'm sorry.
It's all right.
It's nice when someone who's been doing something for a long time also has, you know, as you've spoken about a lot in this class, you gain a lot of skill to do things over and over and over again, but you can always make mistakes. That's the great thing about life. It's a process all the time.
Oh, throwing is going to teach you about self-confidence and self-assuredness and the ability to screw something up really quickly. Alright. Water clay.
About how many pounds is that?
Anybody got any requests? No. Alright.
How many pounds is that, Professor Senn? Approximate.
Five maybe?
That's my guess. So, if you're new at it and you want to know exactly the amount, we do have the scale. So what Rain was talking about is Rain measures out a pound of clay. If a cup is happening.
Only a pound?
Yeah, she was doing a pound.
Well, if a cup is happening, why not throw off the hump?
Yes.
Did she demo throwing off the hump? No! Well, okay, here's my first request. Typically, if I'm throwing, I'm putting 20 pounds of clay on the wheel. Depending on what I'm doing, if I'm throwing off the hump, that's about right. If I'm throwing big stuff, 20 pounds is, you know, it's manageable.
Each of your blocks, those are about 25 pounds. So imagine about the size of a block, you can throw off the hump with that.
Yeah, half a block is a convenient amount. Alright, I turn the motor on for centering. I do use the motor for centering. It takes takes work, it takes effort. If you ask me if I ever had to call an ambulance, somebody asked me that once.
I don't think I did.
I didn't recall ever calling an ambulance. I've had ambulances show up on campus for students who were injured, but they weren't mine. One of my former students and I were talking online the other day. She said, "Do you remember calling the ambulance for my son?" She had a little boiling shot. And somehow she stuck his finger in the motor on the kick wheel. And it broke his finger. I don't think it was me, but she insisted it was me. I called the ambulance. All right, I'm centered. This is really nice place.
I know, I like this. 6, 7
All right, I mentioned I don't buy into most of the Japanese mystical crap. You do need to wipe your clay. Don't use it straight off the block. You just need to do it, bite the bullet. And I do like the Japanese method of kung fu. Theoretically, if you're coning, when you're centering, I'm only centering a small amount of clay at one time. That's a few. I had the whole mass centered, so it doesn't make any difference. The Japanese say it wakes up the clay.
We are different schools. I believe in all that mystical stuff. So we are totally to agree on the outcome being similar.
Miss Mystic.
Yes, I do think that the play is allowed. Absolutely. I am
right. Throwing off the hump. I don't care if the bottom is center. All right, I'm not going to throw at the bottom. It can be off center. All I'm throwing is this piece up here. And you want something small and delicate. I'm going to go ahead and open it up with my thumb. Way I want to do it. A lot of people, if you got a big log, they'll come in this way with three fingers over the top. That way their hands are anchored together. If you can keep your hands touching each other while you're working, you'll be much happier in the long run because you'll have a lot less wobble. They'll anchor up each other. You can't always do that, but when you can.
Those of you who saw Rain's demo yesterday, Rain also talked about if you want to maintain more control. Senn isn't doing this, but you can also put your elbows inside your inner thigh like this. So if you're working with a large piece of clay and you're worried about it moving around while you're centering, keep your elbows inside of your legs. That can be helpful if you're doing it. Yes?
I came in with my index finger down to the bottom, and I just curled it back this way. And that's going to leave a little bit of a curved bottom. Doesn't make any difference. You can flatten it out now, then or later, but it's going to leave a little bit of a curved bottom.
This is a
good bowl. That's a Senn bowl?
I don't think so.
Throwing. Once again, as little water as possible, just not keep it separate. I have my hands touching. I'm going to get my height before I get my width. I have my inside finger higher than my outside finger. I'm going to squeeze in a little bit, and I'm going to pick up that coil, and I'm not going to change this distance. I'm going to lift this distance up. If you're having issues, one of the things my instructor told me, once upon a time, a long time ago, was lock your hands, lock your elbows, lock your everything, and just sit up. Can't do it fast. You gotta wait for that coil to go all the way around. You can pull it up in one long skinny spider. Get back in. Find out where I'm at on the bottom, which is up there. Come out with my inside finger. Establish your coil. And I'm watching my finger marks. One of the advantages of starting a beginner on a kick wheel, it slows down. And it slows down just about the time beginners get in trouble. One of these things is just going to keep on until you play ball. Right? I say use as little water as possible. The prior, one of the prior ceramic teachers would literally go,
"That's what Rain did yesterday."
Oh, gee,
see, different camps. Rain keeps a sponge in her hand, so those of you who didn't see yesterday's demo, and squeezes the water with the sponge as she's actually working. So she keeps it constantly in her hand. But that's what I was mentioning too, is that if you don't clean the water out of the bottom, you can get cracks and you get too much moisture in there. So those sponges on a stick are really useful when you're working on a very large piece, so that you can actually pull that moisture out of the bottom of your pot.
All right, let's push it out with the inside finger. I'm going to try and top in, so I'm putting a little more pressure with the outside finger. I'm actually going to collar this a little bit. Collaring will throw it off center, sorry. We'll do that every time. We'll just move it. That off-center clay, if your pulls are good, your finger spacing is even, and you come up smooth, the off-center clay will end up on your top lip, and you can trim it off.
Talking all week about how I need a giant coffee
mug by someone in the class. Maybe
it's this one. Are you hinting? I might be. I like a large cup of coffee in the morning. I need
a large cup of coffee mug. My coffee mugs are inadequate size.
That's not bad.
Another one
Rain did
yesterday was pretty big.
Yes. But that turned into an ice cream bowl,
remember? Yes. Because she did the slipper.
Didn't you send me that video, Greg, of someone throwing a bathtub?
Yes.
Yeah. People will try to, they'll try to throw, you know, absurdly huge amounts of clay, but he was using the force of the wall to make a bathtub.
He throws hot tubs. He's got a specially designed wheel and he puts 500 pounds of clay on it. He's also built like Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Yes, you really have to be to throw a hot tub.
Yeah, that's about where the bottom, where I'll cut it off. I just wanted to establish that.
It is likely that I will trim this piece for you all, since even with the cut finger I can trim, so that's not going to be too difficult. I'll do another trimming demo next week, since we did it before we did throwing, so you can see trimming again.
Wooden ribs. Wooden ribs let you throw without, almost without water. You have very little contact surf with the surface of the clay, so you have way less drag. So you don't need as much slippery. So you can get things much thinner. Studio set up, I had a mirror right there. If you got a mirror right there, it makes it real easy to see the profile of your pot. I go like this to see over there, then once it gets old and then it gets crinkled. Come on. There it is. Had a funky mark there. made my chamois here when I was here before, did I?
You might have. I did not find it, but it's probably here somewhere if you did not locate it.
I have to go cut new one. I'll leave a couple.
That'd be good.
If I want one car chamois and cut it into little pieces, you get about 800 little pieces of a car chamois.
So those of you who were here yesterday, this is the technique Rain did with the broken up piece of plastic bag. So Rain just took a piece of plastic bag, broke it, curled it around the fingers, and then held it taut to make the edge of the lip rounded. Makes it easier to drink from.
I've never heard of anybody being able to pass a bag. That'd be even cheaper.
Exactly. That was why Rain started. She said she saw it on a video and decided to do that because it was cheap and, well, technically free because there's tons of bags everywhere. I don't know the difference with the, how it feels different from the chamois. I would probably try both now myself. But if you're offering our studio chamois, we'll take them.
I will certainly leave those behind. Alright, this is not traditional. This is not Japanese mystical. This is a propane torch. You cannot use, alright? Anytime I give you a definite you cannot, it's not always true, alright? I'm going to tell you, you cannot use a propane torch for hand building because it concentrates the heat too much. You need to use a heat gun, alright? Now, if you want to texture your clay when you're hand building, propane torch will pop little tiny pieces off your surface and take away the smooth. Okay? The vinegar will do the same thing. And just like when I'm pulling, I'm going to heat the whole thing. If you heat in one spot, you will break your item. I want to get this a little closer to being really hard. Now I got to do something with the surface. Only because Catherine said she wanted to turn it into a top. Are you going to pull a handle, Catherine?
I mean, I guess that should happen.
I don't know how this porcelain would pull.
That's not the porcelain.
Oh, what is this?
This is the cone 6.
Oh, I thought you got out of water porcelain. I like this. Here I am talking about like a Japanese porcelain. This is the exciting part, very basic jungle. This is the watching grass grow part.
Yes, and I usually don't teach this, so this is you getting to watch with the torch, which is not generally in my class, but maybe down the road. If
I thought you got one. Didn't I leave one here?
Did you? If you left one, I don't know where it was. That was Melvis was using it. The heat guns. We don't generally use those very often even for hand building because, again, same thing that Professor Senn's describing. If it's uneven, you risk breaking the piece. So if you're in a hurry to dry it, you could risk breaking it. Since most of the time we're just putting stuff in the greenware room and you're letting it dry naturally, if you were in a hurry, that's why you would do this. And what does it do to the surfacing, Senn?
What
does it do to the surface that differentiates it from...
Oh, if you overheat it?
No, just in general.
This?
Yeah.
Doesn't change anything. All right. Catherine wants a coffee. Excuse me, Dr. Czacki wants a coffee.
Catherine, Dr. C, all of them work.
I have no idea.
People started calling you Dr. Senn this week, and we decided that you deserve the title because you've been here long enough.
No.
You should have the title.
Thanks. I don't even use professor except in formal documents. I will call myself an educator. All of my students tell you I profess the first couple of weeks of the semester when I'm showing slides. I profess to actually know something about art. All right, I usually slap off my carrots. Let's see. Anybody milk the cow? These dogs are somebody.
Yeah.
All right, you, can, you will find this so easy.
Yeah. Oh, you too, too. Yes. My last uncle that ran the family farm had to go to nursing home this week, so last person that was milking the cows as a profession.
This is literally just like pulling on the wheel. I'm squeezing gently. Slightly increasing pressure as I go down. If I get a lump on the end, I'll break it off. Is it going to help me? When I got good clay, I love pulling metals. If you want to buy my office, I got a piece in my office. It's got like 20 or 24 inch metals on it. The coiled rod piece.
All right. And since a lot of you were intrigued by the what we have been calling chaos glaze, we will do another demo on that, which is the sort of tie-dye effect. We will do that glaze on this coffee mug too next week.
I just bumped with my elbow. I'm glad I told you. Storytelling. There's an art fair on the square in Madison, Wisconsin. Madison's the capital of Wisconsin. There's a big square around the Capitol building. And for a week every summer, every artist in the world shows up there. They'll have 400 artists up there. And there's dulcimer makers and potters and jewelers and all kinds of people there. And being, at the time I was there last, which was a long time ago, there was a potter there with a bunch of very delicate little vases, between 8 and 12 inches tall, between 2.5 and 4 inches in diameter. I like that. Alright, you can't heat this, alright? I need to stick this someplace where I won't bump it, and let it dry for a while. I may heat it later. Anyway, I'm going to walk by and it's beautiful. Beautiful little delicate vases. And I reach out and I pick one up, they don't weigh anything. Alright? And I am so impressed because I had tried to throw it thin. And I turn one over, look at the bottom, and sand falls out. He has them partially filled with sand because they are so light the wind blows them apart. I said, how do you do that? This is wooden ribs. He was good. This isn't really going to be a big coffee cup, you realize that, right?
That's pretty big. That is larger than my current coffee cup, so that's just what I want, larger than the current cup. That doesn't feel like enough. I have to refill it, but with this one, I won't have to refill it. I'll just be able to drink the
15% one. 15% drink. You got any dumpster divers? Somebody threw out really nice pieces.
Two of them.
Pieces of wood in a dumpster over behind my building. They're roughly, they're 1x12. And they're really clean, and they're all about 14 inches long, and there's a whole stack of them. All right, when you set stuff down like that, set it down gentle, set it down on something. I said plaster works really well. Wood works really well. You want it on something which can absorb water, rather than on a plastic surface or formica surface. Because that water in the bottom needs to come out. If the rest of it dries and they're still really wet at the bottom, you can get cracked.
You can get what's called an S-crack, especially on plates. So that is also why you want it to dry in a certain way. S-cracks just look like this, right? Except it's the letter S. The other thing you can use to remove pieces from the wheel is we have these. They slide under this piece and then you can pull it up like this.
Not Japanese. If she's using one of those, just go like this and it's not Japanese.
No. Do we have another request? What's the next request? Big soup bowl.
If you're going to make a big bowl, you open your clay low and wide. If you're going to make a plate, you open it low and wide. You don't open it tall and thin.
Too late.
Now, if I'm not sure how thick the bottom is, I can use a needle tool to find out. Put my finger against the needle tool, stick it all the way down, run the needle tool through the clay, hold my finger against the needle, pull it up, and it'll show me how thick the bottom is. I don't have enough room to get my needle tool and my finger in there.
And why do you think you need the bottom to be a little thicker? What would you need thickness on the bottom for? Anyone remember from trimming?
Well, if you're throwing out a plaster bat, you don't. You need to trim the bottom even. You need enough thickness to do that. And I like trimming, I like leaving the actual foot on the bottom. Alright, let's see what I can do with this.
At the end of class, I fired the pieces I threw on the wheel a few weeks ago, so you can see again how the foot looks. That is, about a quarter of an inch. So we did a really large foot for that first trimming demo that we did a few weeks ago.
You notice my bucket just naturally gravitated back right there? She told me to put it on the chair so y'all didn't have time to look through it.
If those of you on this side, if anyone wants to go up and look close to, you can walk up to the... We got this big plastic screen here.
You're welcome to come up and look. That's what it's for.
Yes, I will demonstrate. I'm going to get up close and look because I want to watch the pool. Yep.
Once upon a time when Mary Finneran was teaching ceramics, I happened to wander into the shop the day she was demoing throwing the beginners. And Mary's got a sense of humor that is even more ribald than mine. But she had a sense of humor and she caught on quick. And I watched her demo and she turned her students loose. And I looked at her and I said, "Do you mind if I try that?" She caught on right away. She started laughing. She said, "No, go ahead." So I went over and grabbed a chunk of clay, and I grabbed a big chunk of clay. And the beginners are all looking at me really strange because they all have these little big orange sized things. So I just center that sucker and I pull it on up. I said, "Oh, this is easy, Mary." That was mean. All right, keep control of your grip.
And you see when he's pulling up at that very end stage, you release very slowly. So you're just sort of releasing with the slowest speed.
Now, I'm deep enough, I cannot keep my hands together. If it gets any deeper, which it should, one more pull, I hope. Appears to tell you should have all your height in three pulls. Take any more than that.
Be very careful if you stand up on the hip wheel. Make sure to stand up on the sides where Senn's feet are right now, not on the wheel.
We did have a student break her ankle.
Yes, that is why.
Only one in, 35 years now.
Not in my class, luckily. So none of you have done that yet in our class. That was Mary's class?
When I could switch, I switched over so my hands were touching again.
This is the other reason some people feel more, some people do feel more comfortable on the shorter wheels. So you will know from working on them which one you feel more comfortable with and go with what feels comfortable.
If you run an electric, keep in mind you want to slow down when you get taller, when you get wide. Especially when you get wide, if you're doing bowls, because centrifugal force is way more effective out here than it is in here. Your surface feet per minute. Oh, there's a kettle. Science term for me. Surface feet per minute goes way up. Teaching choir, I would do this, and then I cut everything in half on the wheel, and the students all scream.
I told yesterday's class about that. Rain was not going to cut pieces in half to do that.
Chick. Teach them all bad habits, you know that.
And those of you who were here yesterday, part of why it's great to see multiple people throw is you'll start to see what a variety there is. People throw very differently. And it is good to also watch. I put links on Blackboard to videos, so you might want to watch other people throw because you'll see different techniques, different methods. You'll find yours as you work. They say it's somewhere between 22 and 36 hours to get good at this, especially the centering part. So if you log 22 to 36 hours, that's when you start to be able to have more consistency on the wheel. I don't know if that math's accurate, but that's what's thrown out there mathematically for getting improvement.
Gotta pay your dues.
Gotta pay your dues. Right. So that means some of you are gonna come back next semester and hang out with me some more, because you'll probably wanna pay your dues again.
Now, I'm heating the bottom where I ribbed it. I'm not heating the top edge because I want to go back and throw that top edge. But I got the bottom part thin enough. I don't know if I want to cut this one in half yet or not. That it's,
No.
I don't want to start pulling on the top until I get the bottom just a little drier and a little stiffer.
If you cut it in half, we can't trim it and then glaze it for the sale coming up.
You want me to combine science too, I
think of the children. Think of the children, Senn. And their clay club that is out of money because we spent all our money on t-shirts. There's tears falling, Senn. The t-shirts are worth it. They should be here. Right in time for the sale. Yeah. We did a rush on that.
Also, so they moved to El Portal meeting so I can help out all day.
I think it's Yumi and Sam are the three main people. Jody too, but I don't know where Jody is today. Luckily this is being filmed because I think Jody would be very sad to miss Sam's
Yeah, I know she said she wanted to watch.
I haven't had to trim my lip. I've got my right knee propped right up against the frame. Anything you can do to add stiffness, rigidity to your body. You can clamp right in, especially on the little ones. You can clamp your knees in real tight. That will help.
All right.
Arms up against
too.
The splash pad, you want to lean over your knees.
And this is why Rain was demoing. If you are, if you have less upper body strength, which of course, as you can see, I do have less upper body strength. So I'm going to put my arms inside here. So of course, working with clay has given me a lot more upper body strength, but just to maintain that solidity, you might find that, and if you're new to it too, and you're feeling nervous about making sure that you keep that contact, that is another good strategy, is just arms inside of knees. There were gasps.
There were gasps?
Yeah.
Well, I figured they'd all seen a lip trim before. No Botox available. You get a lump on it, you gotta cut it off.
The two small bowls that you've already seen that I glazed were larger, but yes, I had to trim the lip off because it came out slightly crooked. So that is another way you can straighten your piece too. If you have the top is crooked, but you like the rest of it, it looks good. That widening out, you're sort of slightly pulling out as you pull up. That was what Rain also showed yesterday when doing the vase. So you're collaring by holding two hands. That's called collaring, by putting it in. And then when you bring it out, you're pulling very lightly. And Rain actually did contact like this, thumb on hand, pull out.
This is where it sometimes screws up.
You don't want to do the where we throw the piece of clay at it?
That's next.
Yeah. Should we take a volunteer?
Will I take a volunteer?
Or do you want to do it?
Oh, I'm just going to do it.
Okay, you do it. Good point.
Feet are important. What do you want the bottom of your pot to look like? I like that. I like the contrast between the rough edge and the finished lip.
That was something we talked about too, because one of the bowls I'm firing today has a sort of stucco pattern on the outside. And the way that I did that was with that same wooden tool, and I just pushed it in at the very end and let the clay naturally build up the sides, so it left a sort of textured rough pattern on the outside, and then the inside is totally smooth. So that is, these are some of the other techniques you can use to finish the piece at the end. Oh, there we go.
The wheel's a tool. It's like a computer. Computers don't make art, you gotta make it art. If you're working functionally on the wheel, everything is symmetrical. Do you want to leave it symmetrical, or do you want to change it to make it more interesting? That makes me look really cool.
Are you going to put a handle on it too?
No, you can put a handle on it if you want. You want me to pull you another handle?
Yeah.
It's going to be heavy for a picture.
We could leave it as a vase. You're right. That would be quite heavy as a picture. Up to you. Up to you. We could.
I'll pull a handle, you can put it on if you want to. But in class.
Sweet. It's a pretty dry day today.
Mm-hmm. I just bumped that top edge of my arm again. That's not
those of you in my history classes, you also know I've talked about interesting fact about really ancient ceramics is that this method of handle pulling has been around a really long time. And what usually artists would do is they would press their thumb into the top side, pull the handle down, and press it to the bottom. So we have the thumbprints of, you know, thousands of years of artists in their clay body. And this is still the technique that's used for this type of handle building.
And your choice to have fat side on the bottom and fat side on top. Do you want to spool a 50-pound test fishing line?
Sure.
The plastic works really good for cutoff tools. It's probably better than the cotton.
Oh.
Let it rot.
I only got the cotton because our metal ones just get destroyed.
I don't know.
I don't buy the metal ones anymore.
They'll eat your fingers.
Yes. And the cotton ones, those are nylon, actually. But
okay.
The nylon ones do break off of the wood more quickly is the problem. But I would love, if you're willing to give me some fishing line, I will make, I'll get some dowels and I'll cut them up and I'll make those. Any way you can save money on tools is great too, because then you can make a bunch with fishing line and a dowel rather than buying the tools.
Jay, I have a shop. It's right across the way there. Come on by, we got all kinds of stuff for tools on it. One more time. Alright, I'm putting that bat on here. I've already got grooves. I don't have to pick it up, recenter it.
This is what I did with the cheese that are firing right now. But I tilted up more, so the entire side is all that pulled up.
Now these are really dry. Okay. So I'm putting a little bit of surface moisture on before I put it on the wheel. Otherwise it'll suck the water right out of the clay. Slide right up. And they do slide. If they slide a little bit, you still got your clay on them and you're centered, you're okay. If they slide a lot, just start over there. I used to be real fanatical on center the bass. Shape my clay a little bit. I'm pulling in on the bottom and pushing down diagonally on the top, compressing the clay. Yeah, they found a skeleton. An archaeologist figured out skeletons of a lady. And this is from 5,000 years ago. They determined that the lady was a potter because of the differentiated bone development in her right leg and her left leg. If you do use wooden bats and you got long thumbnails, occasionally they'll catch. And you go, oh, that hurt.
They made the vases and the cups, and then they brewed the stuff.
That's how far off it is. And somebody wanted a bowl.
I need a soup bowl to go with my mom.
It's the only reason she has me come over.
So I can get dishware.
Developing a collection of Senn pottery.
I will bring in next week one of the first times I did the what we're calling tie-dye or chaos glaze was on one of Senn's vases. And this was after a discussion that we also have very different glaze interests. Control, less control. Wants to know how it's going to look in the outcome. I like the experiment. So, this is what's fun about collaborating, is you will get a very different approach.
She lives with serendipity. I was once told I was a control freak, and I just vehemently denied it. And over the years, I may not be a control freak, but with my art, I want it to turn out the way I want it to turn out every time. There's not a whole lot of...
And see, both strategies exist within art making. We're probably pretty evenly split in this class. Some of you really want that control. You want to know what it's going to be like. Some of you probably love that magic of opening the kiln and saying, wait, what happened here? Do I have it in my pocket? Good example, I've been experimenting with multivitamins in glazes. This is selenium in a luster glaze, and it creates an oil slick in the middle. You can pass it around. So you can put selenium or other minerals or metals in the glaze, and it will have a different reaction.
You want to hear something daffy?
What?
Last weekend, the Sloss Foundry, big honking foundry out in Alabama, Georgia, did an online, they do it every other year, biennial thing.
So foundry is for metalwork, generally. For those of you who don't know that terminology.
And they were doing an online exhibition, and I went ahead and applied, and they accepted my pieces. I don't like this one. What am I going to do? I'm going to get rid of it. I don't like this one. Anyway, so they did a whole bunch of workshops. And so online workshops. I went to a bunch of these workshops. And listening to artists talk about how great they are and how wonderful they are and how incredibly astute and important their own artwork is always makes me crazy. And there was this, forgive me, this California artist. She wasn't from California. I have occasionally referred to California people in a disparaging fashion because of the prevalence of the mystical and stuff that happens mentally in California. So anyway, this young lady, and she just fresh out of grad school, was one of the featured speakers at the Sloss convention. And I'm looking, she looks like she's 12 years old. And she's talking about mugwort and the importance of mugwort and the fact that this is sustainability in the industry, all right? She has gone out along the railroad tracks. Mugwort supposedly collects minerals and purifies the soil. So she collected, I have no idea how many pounds of mugwort, and then she sintered it, and she reduced it down to get the iron out of the mugwort plant. And she's making little teeny tiny railroad spikes out of the sintered iron. And I'm going, lady, you're crazy. This is cool.
Different camps.
It's like, my goodness. Look, too wet.
But, beyond mysticism, we've talked about in this class too, lots of indigenous cultural traditions around ceramics. So, Puglowan, or if you go Diné, Navajo, if you go to Japan, if you go practical purpose. So they make a lot of sense. They are also ways of containing history for other cultures. So a lot of the stories and the mysticism are forms of storytelling and forms of history and forms of knowledge that are passed down generation to generation.
That part I buy.
That part is what Professor Senn buys. And that is the part that is most interesting about working with ceramics, too, is the prevalence of all these ideas. There's a great archaeological book on the significance of ritual in ceramic forms. For a long time, this was very understudied because a lot of archaeologists thought, oh, we're just looking at functional stuff. But they kept finding mass burial sites of ceramics that would have things like animal bones or little fragments that had inscribed writing. And they realized that people were also doing these ritual practices with the pieces. So they weren't just functional. They had a multitude of purposes. And some of that had to do with foundation work. So when laying a house, there were traditions in Ireland of putting a pot underneath inside the wall if it was a place where music was played or dancing would happen, because the idea is the acoustics would improve. Whether or not that's true is debatable, but I know a group of musicians in Texas who read this book on my recommendation, and now we're installing pots in all of their walls for the recording studio. So I will let you know how the experiment goes. But we are going to make giant pots for them to embed in the walls of their building. The other thing that was found is the skeletons of horses, particularly the skulls, because it supposedly made the acoustics of floors better. So a lot of these interesting ritual traditions, and they overlap with ceramics, would be performed. When doing a new house, the tradition was to put broken ceramics at the corner. And this was thought to be just metaphysical, mystical, but it also was found later that this potentially helps the building settle because of the way the air distributes through the broken fragments. So it could have an actual scientific reason for working as well.
I never used my clay without working.
Oh, that's the piece you didn't like that you...
Yes.
Simple.
Something crazy.
Two ribs. One rubber, one wood.
Yeah,
did I see that correctly? Inside rib is made of rubber. The outside rib is made of wood. So two different, and those are both called ribs, but one is the rubber one, one is the wood one.
I like that shape a whole lot better. When you first start throwing, it's deceptive. You tend to throw things the size they already exist at. And you're going to have 15% shrinkage in anything you make. When I started, I made a set of nice coffee cups. Oh.
They
so,
know this from their hand building, because how many of you, I think, I remember Sam, you had a coffee mug that was much smaller than you expected after we fired it, right? And that shrinking at, you know, 15-17% doesn't sound like much, but it's quite visible.
Oh, my set of matched teacups, which was required in the beginning class. Or my set of matched coffee cups was matched teacups. I know about 6 ounces, just that's not a coffee cup.
it doesn't end up collapsing. That's a ramen bowl. Those of you who are here next year, we're talking about with student clubs, the Clayhounds, doing an international, there used to be what was called the Chili Bowl. When the Clayhounds existed back in the 1990s, if any of you are interested, I found some hilarious and fun pictures of the original Clayhounds. For some reason, they all posed laying down on the piano together. I don't know where they got the piano, but that is the picture. We did talk about using that for the t-shirt this year. We decided against it. But they had a chili bowl every fall where they would serve, they would make throw bowls or hand-filled bowls, fire them, and serve chili in the community. And then people could buy a bowl of chili and they would take home the bowl. Depending on what everything happens with current pandemic status, we would like to do this in the fall again, but we were thinking, being that we have such a diverse and amazing community at ENMU, we could do an international event. So we could have many different kinds of ceramics that are international, and also have the international food idea. So people could bring their own recipes, they could make some of their own items, and then bring them to sell off with the bowl, which could be quite fun. TBD on that, but if you're interested, I know a lot of you have joined the Clayhounds and will be here next year, so that is what we might work on in the fall or the spring, depending.
I toss out looking at a football tailgate, we're going with Ray Koss too.
Oh yeah.
To sell chili, if you guys did a chili cook-off out there.
They used to do the chili one, yeah.
Yeah.
Ray is the one who suggested that we could do, because we were talking about doing an international club thing.
Right, I mean, that's an idea, but another one, I mean, if you want to get in front of students, there's usually 200 to 300 students out there, depending on the pandemic this fall, so. So just FYI, if you guys go to a football game, like the homecoming game or WT or something like that.
Yeah, WT would be a good one.
WT? Yeah.
WT gets the most people.
Is it WT?
West Texas, it's our
My alma mater, what do you mean, what's WT?
I went to Utah. That is what I know.
I had a WT sticker in my back window of the car for River and Day, and Kathy Salter was one of the math people here. She gave me grief one day about this WT sticker in my window, and I just said, that's what I got my degree from. She said, well, I guess it's okay.
I got a little bit of grief for wearing my
Senn
alma mater shirt to sweatshirt when I moved here. Beautiful.
A little lumpy on the inside.
You can always turn that down when it's leather hard too. We've talked about that. If it's leather hard, you can do it on the banding wheel. So if you wanted to get rid of the little lumps on the bottom there, you could do that on the banding wheel. You could leave it, let the glaze do its magic with those lumps.
She speaks heresy. Trimming the inside, come on. Showed you how it is rolling over in the grave.
Good thing he's my favorite.
I mentioned Shoji Hamada. Shoji Hamada and Bernard Leach are responsible for a lot of the tradition. You know, we're supposed to include history in our content. They are responsible for a lot of the traditional stuff that is currently done in this country, which wasn't traditional when they introduced it. Shoji Hamada was named a living artist in Japan. As being one of the half a dozen who contributed to the nature of the ceramic industry. Bernard Leach was an English individual who grew up in a potting family who ended up going to Japan, meeting Shoji Hamada, and spending years learning the Japanese tradition and learning porcelain, which didn't exist in England. At the time, porcelain's been around in Asia for literally 3,000 years. We were building wood fire kilns, which would go to Kong Tan, using updraft technology. And so he studied over there, and then he came back to England, and he introduced a lot of the ideas. And a lot of those ideas are the serendipity, the spontaneous action, the gestural science, which was not being done in England at the time. It was very much controlled.
There is one of the documentaries, I know a lot of you have already watched it, that I haven't watched for, shows a Japanese family who passed down ceramics for thousands of years. And one thing they do, too, is they still use a wheel that is powered by an assistant, not by electricity. And the wheel was originally invented in Korea. So we know that the potter's wheel came from Korea and then spread out from there to China and Japan. And so what's interesting about art and where it develops is sometimes it'll fall out of practice in one place and then become more common in use in another. Celadons, the blades, we talked about that a lot. Those were developed in China and then spread towards Korea. So there's a lot of shared things happening artistically in terms of one culture developing real and then the other culture developing, and a lot of intercultural exchange of those forms.
A lot of that was from military conquest.
That too. Still is today. There's a lot that happens when cultures meet through military conquest, and then their artists share ideas with each other.
All right, I got a good word for you.
So apparently not in the case of Buddhism, that spread relatively peacefully for a while, until it didn't. Started out spreading peacefully. Then it didn't. Then it did again. Any requests?
Because they need to dry slow, and you need to keep running the wire under them so they don't stick. And they'll stick to that metal. They stick less to wood and even less to plaster, because plaster is subculture. All right.
We do have a few plaster, we don't have plaster bats, but we have a few, other than this surface, we have some plaster plates, or sort of rectangles. So if you did make a plate and you could dry them on there, just let me know and I can show you where those are.
I got 1,000 pounds of plaster from one of my bags.
Ask me if I have time to do that right now.
What? Come on! College teaching is a gravy job! I'm quoting my advisor, my chairman of my thesis. It's a grading job. What they pay you for is the grading. And that used to be true. It's not anymore. Now it's an administrative job. We need more paperwork. All right. I've centered the clay very low. I've opened it up on the inside way out to here already. And I'm just going to ease this back over the top.
This is again this is the somewhat shape that's going on inside, this sort of indented, just pulling the fingers inside here.
Right now I've got a very thick-walled bowl. And I'm going to exert a lot of pressure down because I want it to come out across the back. As I come out with my fingertips. Probably a good thing, it's a good request. Is there something I thought of earlier? It was like doing those other forms that ain't gonna make any difference. When you do plates, we refer to that nasty S crack. One advantage of doing plates on a wheel that you can reverse is you can rip that bottom backwards.
And does that help prevent the S crack?
Yes. Awesome. Stresses the clay the other direction.
That's sort of like trimming on the inside. You would call that shaping, right?
Absolutely. You shape with the rib. You trim with trim tools. May notice handling the porcelain can be really fun, but it's got a window.
Yep.
And it's workable, and then it's not workable. You got to be very aware where that window is when you're working with it.
If you are doing hand building, that's why, and I showed you the pinch form. So one of the books that I'm trying to scan for you all, if I can get the permission, is an artist who only worked in pinch forms for about 4 decades. So they just only did pinch pots, but imagine doing everything pinch. So sculpture, pinching out a coffee mug where you pinch out the handle from the form, and it's gonna look very different. It looks a lot more raw and rough. With porcelain, you have to do it really quickly. So the mugs that I fired this week, I did all of those in one very quick sitting because the workability of the porcelain goes away very quickly. People really like porcelain for slip casting. So we don't usually do slip casting in the intro class, but I'm thinking about working it in next year because there's some interest in it. It's where you make a mold and then you actually liquefy the porcelain down to a slip texture and you pour it into the mold and then you let it get hard. That's how people get those really realistic, almost, if you see a bust where it's a head made out of porcelain, that's generally how you do that rather than hand building. I might have that many people doing those kind of sculptures, but there will be someone in the future that wants to learn the technique. Look at that plate.
Making molds is something we do a lot of in the sculpture class and design class.
Yes. So if you're interested in mold making, you can also take Professor Senn's class.
Or you can just say, hey, show me how! I do that too.
That's generally how this class works too. There's a lot of, I want to do this. All right, let's do that then. That's how I started doing kintsugi at the end of the semester, which the setup is over there, some of you might have seen. We will do the kintsugi next week, which is a reminder, is dealing with broken ceramics. So it is an old Japanese art form that believes that when a ceramic is broken, it is not something you throw away. Instead, that you can repair it with gold dust and resin, and that will actually add to the beauty of the piece, is the idea of that. There are artists in Japan who still primarily practice kintsugi. So they might not even be a potter, but they have a kintsugi studio, and people bring them their broken things, and then these people are masters of kintsugi. We're going to use contemporary, this type of eco resin that's a non-toxic resin, but traditionally, types of sort of tar, pine sap, and resins are used that take 6 months to cure. So this is why kintsugi is a very specialized art as well. We're going to use a faster dry material next week when we do it. And by popular request, I got the green powder as well as gold. So gold is the traditional one. We will use green if any of you want to use it. And that is the chamois. Again, that is a chamois that you can use to smooth the surface.
All right, it's 5:30. I ran out of throwing clay, but I got two handles over here.
Yes.
Bet that handle is almost ready to go on.
And none of you have to clean up, so we can stay and watch handles for the end of the class.
I did not bring over my cheat scoring tool.
Do you want me to grab one?
I'm just using the old tool. If you're going to do a lot of scoring and stuff, if you find an old stiff bristled toothbrush and you take out every other set of bristles, they work really well for creating a slippy surface. Oops! I bumped the edge of the plate. It's no longer perfectly round. Oh,
I will carry that over to the camera, and I will give you a thing that you've been requesting. Oh, I dinged it!
No, I used my needle tool. I cut myself on all those things once. Reclaim clay. Oh man, don't put needle tools. Don't be careful. Don't get needle tools or ribs in the reclaim clay. Because somebody will stick their hand in there. It's the voice of experience. I just, I want to point this out, because I'm being a snob. I'm being an elitist artist and a professor for a minute. You see this whole lake of water on the pan out here? And this whole lake of water running out of the splash pan? You don't need that whole lake of water, just saying. All right. These are debtors. I got a lot of calls. All right, let's find out. If you're going to pick up a leather hard pot, you do want your hands clean and dry. You leave a lot less marks on the surface. Oh, actually, we are close enough. Oh, damn. Maybe. Fiddling knife! Fiddling knife, girl, you got a fiddling knife? Mm. I thought you'd It's the only reason I said it that way. I'm gonna get behind this screen. I'll get by without it. Never mind. I used my needle tool. It's okay. Next time I demo, I'll bring everything.
They are on the shelf that is too high for me to reach because my studio has been put. The bins on the shelf that the professor cannot reach. That's why you might have heard me jumping over there. They're on the top shelf.
You know they make these little step ladder things? I got one in my shop. I went into the shop one night and there's this white plaster circle on the floor. Somebody taking my investment bucket, dry investment, turned it upside down on the floor, right on the rug there. And I'm looking at it going, what the heck? So we cleaned it up, and a week later, there's one over on by the other sink, same circle. But the bucket is still sitting there. And I'm looking at the upside down bucket. Custodians are short. They're using the buckets to reach the towel dispensers. Like, I got a folding step ladder, all right? Let's use a folding step ladder. All right, which way do I want to do this? That's the question.
Yeah. Okay, so you see what's happening here, folding this form.
This is where knowing your clay body is important. Because it's really easy at this point to make your handles way too small. That's what we're going to do. We're going to do that. Come back part. Come back part. We'll come back part. All right. It's going to work just like that. Lip's got a lump on one spot, so I'm going to put the handle where the lump is, even though she'll clean that off.
If I remember to do it tomorrow.
If not, the lump won't be where her lips are.
This is just the needle tool, but just making hatch marks. You just want to make sure, like when you're using the scoring tool, that you have a little pattern of hatch marks.
I guess you have a toothbrush.
Stiff bristle toothbrush.
The idea here is these clays, these two pieces are different consistencies. And I want them to bond together. So I'm creating a slip surface. It's not just the scratches, it's actually adding water so you get actual slip forming on the surface. Some people actually keep a little pot of slip around.
Do you want some slip? I got a big old bag. No?
I said some people. I But you do want to work it into the surface so that you get some depth to your marks. And that you do get a nice slick surface. Players in class earlier today. And I looked at him and said, unless you want to look like an art major, I don't want to violate Title IX or anything here, but you need to brush your butt off before you leave the classroom. And he looked at me like I was dumb. He had just white plaster up one side of his side. Oh, man.
Was that clay, Sean?
Yeah. Okay.
Clay was one of our best intro makers, and his teammates made fun of him for being good at ceramics.
Well, it's not me to say that we're good. Cleaning up my seam.
I always do that for wood holes. It's my favorite.
I usually do too. Mm-hmm. But this was a matter. What's there? And just cuz.
Are you going to throw something at it?
Nope.
It's a functional coffee
cup. I'm not going to do that as a functional coffee cup.
About leather hard? Yep. Oh. Functional or decorative?
This? Oh, that's decorative. You got a lot of airspace in there. Alright, if I were functional, the production pot, and I tried that for a while. They figure 2 minutes per piece. You do a coffee cup in 2 minutes, you do a bowl in 2 minutes, you can have 3 minutes for a plate. You're throwing off the hump, you throw it, cut it off, set it aside, throw it, cut it off, set it aside. Literally, 2 minutes per item, and you want them all to come out identical. Alright? $25, there you go. If you do that, you're throwing off the hump, and you cut them reasonably well, you can just take your fingertips, run it right around this bottom edge, and it's finished. There's no trimming involved. All right, they're into production rather than. Rather than spending a whole lot of time making things absolutely pristine and perfect. So. All right, any questions? Any observations? How at any time? You want to make molds, come by the shop. We do lots of them. You want plaster backs to throw on, come by the shop. You want to cut wooden backs to throw on, come by the shop. I got all the tools.
Someone loves fire.
Thank you for coming by.